This world is not my home, I'm just a passing through. My treasures are laid up somewhere beyond the blue. The angels beckon me from heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. Oh Lord, you know I have no friend like you. If heaven's not my home, then Lord, what will I do? The angels beckon me from heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. They're all expecting me, and that's one thing I know. My Savior pardoned me, and now I onward go. I know He'll take me through, though I am weak and poor, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. Oh Lord, you know I have no friend like you. If heaven's not my home, then Lord, what will I do? The angels beckon me from heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. Just up in glory land,
please. Song of Invitation This Morning will be 761. 761. Now, Brother Norman.
Thank you, Ken, for our singing. John Adam, appreciate that prayer, Kate, our scripture reading. I do believe John Adam was talking about me trying to keep focus this morning because we had a little storm come through Amory last night. And from about 1 to 3 o'clock, Socks, our dog, just would not quit barking. Every time it would thunder, that dog would just start barking. And Joy says, "Can't you get your dog quiet?" I hush, socks, but it didn't work at all. I finally had to bring her bed into our bedroom, pull it right by where I was sleeping, and then take my finger and put it on top of her head. As long as I had my finger on top of her head, wasn't any problem. I mean, she didn't bark, she didn't do it, she was fine. Take my finger off her head. Man, I got a spoiled dog, no doubt about that. But that dog's a good dog. Had her for many, many years and enjoyed it. As the soldiers appear there in the garden, Judas the betrayer comes over and does his dirty deed. And in John 18:10 there, Peter draws his sword out and aims for the old Malchus's neck. Malchus leaned over, and all Peter got was that one ear over there. But listen to what Jesus told Peter in Matthew 26:52. put your sword back in its place. Do you think that I cannot appeal to my father and he will at once put at my disposal more than 12 legions of angels? But now listen real closely here to what he said. How then will the scriptures be fulfilled which say that this must happen in this way? How then will the scriptures be fulfilled? Now there in Matthew and Mark and John we find several folks very close to Jesus standing at the foot of the cross. We've got John, a disciple. We've got Mary, the mother of Jesus. We've got Mary, the mother of the sons of Zebedee there. We've got Salome, the sister to Mary. We've got Mary, the wife of Clopas. And we've got Mary Magdalene. They're all close there at the foot of the cross. Now, there were some standing evidently a little bit further away. And then there was others standing even further away. All of them had witnessed and experienced the, some by now, 15-hour persecution, that ordeal of Roman punishment. They had seen Jesus go through all of this, and they had no doubt cried, and all of them felt helpless. They could not help this man whom they've come to love so much. Roman soldiers made sure, they made sure that the king of the Jews had been punished appropriately. It was about the third hour of the day when that cross was raised up. And for the next 6 hours there at the foot of the cross, just think about that. Many of us as parents have been in our bedrooms of our children, and we've no doubt dropped to our knees there as our children were sick or going through trials and tribulations or whatever. And we know what it's like in those type of situations. They watched Jesus, a man that they loved so dearly. They witnessed basically the breath of life that just came out of him. And I know you know how watching a loved one who is ill or sick. They watched as that crucifixion took its toll. Jesus, no doubt, looking down upon them, saw what they were going through. And maybe in his mind, you know, he was saying, don't they remember that I told them that it had to happen this way? His very reason for being there, the mission that he was given by the Father, was that of being the sacrifice, the blood sacrifice of God the Father for our sins, for their sins, even, of those at the foot of the cross. Did they not realize, did they not understand that Scripture said it must be this way? This is the way it's got to happen. And then at the sixth hour, darkness fell upon the land, and just think about how the mood would feel then. If we'd have thunderstorm clouds come in and all of a sudden it got dark outside. Think about how it would feel. Obviously it was more troubling. And all the suffering and pain and agony that they still had to witness under this dark, dark cloud. And their utter disbelief. How could this be happening? This is not the way, they would think. And Jesus would say, don't you know? This is the way it has to be. And then just before he said, it is finished. We're told in Matthew 27:46 and Mark 15:34 that Jesus shouted in a loud voice, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani. This shout no doubt had to be heard by those near the cross and even those out a little further. What did he say? What did he say? There was some of this. He's shouting for Elijah to come and save him. Let's see if Elijah comes and helps him down off that cross. Is that what he said? were saying, hey, he's calling for Elijah, they were just showing their ignorance, really, of Scripture at that point. They were evidently not familiar enough with Scripture to know what it said. They didn't recognize this phrase. We've heard it before, too. But do we understand it? Do we understand it? My God, why have you forsaken me? I believe with all my heart that those at the foot of the cross heard Jesus say that. And I believe they understood what he said. And I believe today, hopefully, it's in our understanding of what this phrase means. That we will be able to pull some encouragement from this scripture, maybe, that we haven't ever had pulled from before. For encouragement. Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani. It's been said, and I've heard, maybe in the past was taught, that it's at this point that God the Father turns his back on his Son, Jesus Christ. Why? Because of the sins of the world that Jesus evidently, of course, has laid on himself. This is the blood sacrifice. And so to speak, let's say a bond between Jesus and God. Broken. Sort of a breaking of fellowship. 2 Corinthians 5:21, sometimes used here to prove this thought. He made him who knew no sin to be sin on our behalf. And so you see, I've been told that, you know, sin and God can't occupy the same place, so therefore God has to turn and maybe just kind of get away from his Son. Let's look at this a little bit this morning. Notice the usage there. My God. That's what was said there. Now, just a few hours earlier, if you'll remember, how was Jesus approaching God? You remember he used the title, Father? Father? And you know, with what was Jesus seeing, what was happening at the foot of the cross, don't you think that Jesus might say something that would uplift them? All of them were in dire straits there. Jesus saw it right there. And then, you know, it kind of sounds like in that shout that, you know, Jesus might be saying, my God, why have you forsaken me? But is that what this verse says? Let's look a little closer here. I think that we'll find out that this verse does not say that there was a separation. It does not say that there was a clean break between God and Jesus and God turns his back on his Son. No, it doesn't say that. We don't find that either. This is man's interpretation of this. And we need to look at it. You know, after all, God's come face to face with sin. Even in the Garden of Eden, he came face to face with Adam and Eve there who had sinned. And then the meeting in Job. Satan himself comes right into the company of God there. Face to face. They even have a conversation. And then what about all of those Old Testament sacrifices where God was right there in the tabernacle? And all of those sinful people brought these sins into him for the priest to offer the sacrifices to be, those sins to be passed over. Nothing is said about God looking away or turning away or removing. himself as man was repenting of his sin. In just two verses prior, there in verse 19, we're told that God and Christ were actually together. Right before he said that God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them, and he has committed to us the world of reconciliation. Therefore, it may prove beneficial for us to really look at this. Look at this phrase. Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani. My God, why have you forsaken me? Again, it's probably been 15 hours or so. Don't know for sure, somewhere about that. Jesus was praying in the garden. He knew his hour was coming. We are told he was very troubled, very distressed. His soul was deeply grieved. Grieved even to the point of death, we're told. He was in severe agony. His sweat became like drops of blood. He fell on his face to the ground and started to pray. Father, if it be possible, allow this cup to pass. And he was saying, Abba, Father, all things are possible for you. Remove this cup from me. Jesus was in such turmoil, such distress, that God the Father sent an angel to help comfort Jesus. And Jesus prayed three times, allow this cup to pass. Yes, these actions certainly showed the humanity of Jesus at that time. Showed that he was troubled with the anticipation of things happening like we are many times. If Jesus didn't know what cup, why would he pray to remove this cup? Why would he do that? Again, in John 18, Jesus told Peter to put the sword into the sheath. The cup which the Father has given me, Jesus says, shall I not drink of it? What if he didn't know? How could he say, hey, I'm not going to drink till I not drink of it? Are there any of us out there really who really, really believe that Jesus Christ, the Son of God, did not know the exact role that he was to play in this cup? Are we to believe that Jesus didn't know what was happening? Are we to believe that Jesus didn't know what this cup would bring? Are we to believe that Jesus did not know the exact reason for him having to bear this cup and for Scripture to be fulfilled this way? Remember, some say that Jesus has just asked the Father a question. My God, why have you forsaken me? Are any of us willing to say that Jesus Christ did not already know the answer to that question? Are we willing to say that Jesus Christ didn't know the Scripture? Let's just consider Genesis 12:1 and John 1:2 that talks about Jesus being the Passover lamb. Again, that was Genesis 12:1-11. Are we to say that Jesus didn't know about this? Are we to say that Jesus didn't know about Deuteronomy 32:43 that talks about him being an atonement for sin? Are we to say that Psalms 40:6-8, Jesus didn't know about this? Jesus being the sacrifice for our sins, and I'll be happy to give any of you all of these verses as well as discuss with you what I'm saying today. Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani. I submit to you this morning that Jesus was full aware of his role that he was playing in what was going to happen. If he did know, then why would Jesus ask that question? My God, why have you forsaken me? Let's consider a couple of things. Is it really believable that God the Father would sever a tie with his Son? Is it believable that a bond would be broken? Is it believable that God himself would completely turn his back on his Son at the worst possible moment of his entire life? We should consider Joshua 1:5 and Hebrews 13:5, where it says that he will never leave nor forsake his people. If he states that he would never leave or forsake his people, why do we believe he's going to leave and forsake his own Son? John 10:30, Jesus says that the Father and I are one. Matthew 3:16 says, God saying, "This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased." And again in Matthew 17:5, up on the Mount of Transfiguration, as it's called. They don't know exactly where that mountain is, but God again praises his Son. And in John 17:11, 21, and 22, Jesus says that he and the Father are one. Yet to many, it's contended that God forsake, left, turned his back on his Son, Jesus Christ. Folks, there's no example in the Bible that in an offering for sin in the Old Testament, that this sin, this evil, ever blows back upon, all right, the worshiper, the priest, or really anyone else. Yes, God may turn away from our sin. He may hide himself from our sin. Those are passages reflecting, you know, God's hatred of sin. God does not like sin. But with those coming to God and making a proper scriptural sacrifice to God, there's never a time when we're told that God turns away from us, particularly making the sacrifice for the sin. And that's what's happening here. Jesus is making a sacrifice on our behalf for us, for our sins. In fact, this sacrifice has taken away the sins, remember? And as Kate read in Ephesians 5:2, look at what it says. The sacrifice of Jesus upon the cross was called what? Called what? A fragrant aroma to God. Why would God turn his back on a fragrant aroma? I suggest to you this morning, he would not. And he does not. And he will not. God's not going to turn his back on us as we come to him confessing our sins. Do you think that's what happens when we get in the aisle and we come down here and we want to confess our sins, we want to rededicate our life, we want to come back to God? Do we believe that God turns his back? On us? Are you kidding me? What then, though, as we enter into the last phase of our lesson this morning, what then do we take from this Eli, Eli, Lama Sabachthani? It's a cry that we really don't talk about a whole lot, really don't study a whole lot. But in all of the verses today, I want you to remember, this is the one right here. Psalm 22, beginning there in verse 1. 22:1, written by David. Guess what David says when he begins this psalm? My God, my God, why have you forsaken me? The same thing that Jesus said upon the cross. Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani. See, it's the last, next to the last thing, really, that before Jesus died, when he said, it is finished. And he gave up his spirit. Yeah, David used this psalm, certainly properly, and David calling upon, my God, why have you forsaken me? And any of us who've studied any Old Testament scripture at all knows that David's running for his life, David's hiding in caves, David's going everywhere, running, and he was very low in some parts, lots of parts of his life there. He was going through some tough times. It could very well be, and as easy to see, with all of David's problems, David could very well feel like God had abandoned him because of what he's going through. And he had, my God, why have you forsaken me? Why have you forgotten about me? Why have you left me? Why have you turned your back? Scripture was not divided as easily as it is now for us. You know, back then they couldn't say, well, turn to Psalms 22:1 and let's read this. No, scripture wasn't written that way at that time. Scripture was known and remembered and recognized by the thought at the beginning of the text. Therefore, the phrase, my God, why have you forsaken me, would have taken the listener back to the entire passage that was being said. They'd go back to the entire text and look at the entire text, which we now know to be Psalm 22:1 through 31, is where that thought is. And guess what? There are references there, several references there of the prediction of the suffering of Jesus Christ. It's references to the mocking there. It's reference to the actual crucifixion there in Psalm 22. And all of that prophecy there takes up about half of Psalm 22. But it's also, you see, can be paralleled with those things that Jesus is going through. It's almost a parallel there of David's life with Jesus' life here. And some commentators even say that it's all about Jesus. And then somewhere about halfway down through there, this is said there in verse 24, for he has not despised nor abhorred the affliction of the afflicted, nor has he hidden his face from him. But when he cried to him for help, he heard. I contend to you and suggest to you this morning, and I think it will help us be encouraged, if we would look at this psalm and say, hey, you know, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, was Jesus himself still teaching, still trying to uplift these people that he's looking at? He is still trying to get them to go back, okay, to the scripture in a last teaching moment as a reminder, hey folks, this is the way it's supposed to happen. This is the way it's been prophesied. This is the way it's been taught. This is the whole message that I've been trying to tell you folks. He's trying to calm the fears, calm the anxieties, calm the troubled hearts of those who are witnessing what has been prophesied. God did not turn his back on his son. We should not turn our back on our God either. We should not forsake our own Savior. Jesus sacrificed his sins, and it was a pleasing aroma. And that sacrifice was accepted by God. In the same manner that he accepts our sacrifices here today. And as God is in this meeting with us in our gathering here upon the first day of the week, do not believe that he has turned his back on us. He hadn't done it. Let us take from our thoughts this morning that Jesus, God, they're with us. They're with us. They're not going to desert us. And Jesus did not allow the pain or the hurt, the suffering, and the lack of air, and the gasping for air, and all of this pain upon the cross. He didn't allow that to stop him from teaching, even unto the point of his death. I suggest to you this morning that that's what this phrase is talking about. Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani. Hey folks, go back to Scripture. See what it has to say. This morning God points us to Scripture as well. After Jesus' resurrection and right prior to his ascension, he said this to his disciples, "Go, make disciples of all nations, baptizing them and teaching them to observe all that I commanded you." And listen to what he says next. "I am with you always, even until the end of the age." How long, Jesus? How long are you going to be with us? "I am with you always, even to the end of the age." We can help you this morning. We can pray for you and your family this morning. If we can assist you in being baptized this morning, we can assist you in coming back to God. Hey folks, God's arms are open. Jesus' arms are open. Let's come to him face to face. If we can help this morning, let it be made known while we stand.
645, we'll sing the third verse, and then we'll take the Lord's Supper. In that old rugged cross, stained with blood so divine, a wondrous beauty I see. For 'twas on that old cross, Jesus good to see everyone. I want to thank Norman for a wonderful lesson. As we depart, and I forgot who has the closing prayer, but we're going to sing number 121. We'll sing the first verse of 121, and we'll be having our closing prayer.
Life on this earth that we are able to learn from. Ask you to forgive us when we fail there. In Jesus' name.